You know what you gotta do.
Hello, everybody. So my name is Francisco.
Hamza Issa.
Simon Kao.
And we're here presenting on Chapter 7, Office and Industrial Real Estate Analysis. So the main concept we want you guys to get away from this is to understand the trend for the merging of office and industrial zones, and be able to recognize the key differences between the two in order to make a proper analysis. So an introduction. This chapter highlights important factors to be considered in office and industrial analysis, such as, like we said before, the trend for the merging of the office and the light industrial zones, economic trends and market value, office and industrial space, zoning, heavy industrial, and some key factors and comparisons. So, industrial and office real estate. Industrial and office real estate share many similarities and are often analyzed using similar assumptions. So, light industrial zoning is the most common type of industrial zoning and refers to the low impact in the environmental safety and noise category. So, light industrial and office real estate are usually treated in a similar manner because they overlap a lot of their stuff. So like an example is a clean manufacturing operation such as pottery plant. This example isn't really a like higher impact, heavy industrial factory, but it's not an office. Everybody would say it still is industrial. So kind of like a quick little thing I wanted to show you guys is this example right here, a commercial printing operation. You know, just kind of ask yourself this, what would you think this is? Would this be a commercial office, or would you, you know, categorize this as a light industrial? So it kind of really depends on what you're printing and the details, and this is something that we want you guys to kind of like get away from this presentation is, you know, a lot of stuff overlaps. So you're going to want to, when you're doing your analysis, you're going to want to dive in and see exactly what is going to be required of the building. So why should you care? Well, collectively, office and industrial property is the largest commercial property market in the United States. On average, office and industrial sales accounted for 62% of the entire market. Sales as of 2002, office and industrial property amounted to just over 36 billion, apartments over 13 billion, retail over 8 billion, and lodging over 1.4 billion. So this is kind of just a little image to kind of help you guys see just how big of a market this is. So space requirements. Office space is usually analyzed on the basis of square feet per employee. Industrial structures are normally oriented toward the specific space requirements for the activity itself. Meaning, you know, in office we're going to see a lot of divisions, kind of like how we see even the school. There's a lot of compartments versus industrial side. You get there, it's a big open space so people can do their work. So recognizing the advantages to flexibility and design of an office-sized industrial complex that may be designed to respond to a variety of tenant requirements, including specific design criteria for tenants able to commit to a long-term leases. The combined markets and feasibility studies involved with office spaces often rely upon first finding a major tenant, or in the case of corporate offices, occupying a building as a headquarters or major division office, although this is sometimes hard to do.
Spaces can basically be categorized into three different classes when you're looking for a building. The first one would be Class A building, which is the most attractive to investors and higher successful people such as lawyers and consultants. These buildings are usually characterized by the quality of materials, design, and bonuses or amenities. It also usually has an easy accessible location. Class B buildings are just basically older buildings with little outdated equipment, usually occupied by nonprofit organizations, advertising firms, and other smaller scale businesses, while Class C buildings are just very old, with super outdated everything basically, and it's usually rental option. Instead of classes, industrial buildings are more classified into larger categories, so basically you'll want to find a warehouse for manufacturing or research and development, and there's also warehouses for warehousing and distribution. When searching for these offices or spaces, you got to remember that both office and industrial spaces are now often designed to fit the needs of the tenant or property owner. You usually want to look into how much space you need and other bonuses such as rate abatements where the tenant basically doesn't have to pay rent There's also expense reimbursements because normally when we build a building, it's put onto the rent as because different tenants need different stuff and stuff like that.
Next is heavy industrial projects. So the greatest problem for developers and owners that they face in heavy industrial is finding a suitable location and proper zoning approval and environmental concern. For approvals case, for some types of heavy industrial projects, they need local approval and it can go to states and to the level of federal. So there are types of project, three important aspects to such land use that analysts keeps in mind. Operational design, landlord risk, and equipment storage and use. So the operational design is heavy industrial application are core to the company's primarily business, so they need to factor that the analyst. Landlord risk, meaning that there's going to be environmental contamination in the case of power plant and the water treatment plant, for example, they incinerate their sludge. Where are they going to put that ash? If it's in California, it might be a bit strict, and if it's other places, it might be different regulations. And equipment and storage and use, meaning that these are very specialized, delicate materials, and if they're going to be moving them from place to place is going to take a lot of money and time, so they have to consider that. So some comparison between light industrial and heavy industrial. So light industrial have zoning advantage for multiple reasons, from environmental standpoint, and the light industrial have less pollution, noise, safety, etc. And this gives them the advantage of publicity, like he said earlier, and for market. And on the other hand, heavy industrial can have a lot of traffic for trucks. That needs to sometimes they can be in a remote location where they need to create their own roads to get to major highways. That will cost extra time and money. And there may be a lot of resistance, like I said earlier, on getting required permits. That might take years because of, there's a lot of rules and a lot of nonprofits, for example, like NEED or Environmental Protective Agency coming after these kind of industries. To kind of wrap it up quickly, there are other major considerations like location, access to major highways, proximity to rail lines or ports, and access and from sites and as well as distance. So to just recap a little bit, to the access to major highways, there's going to be lots of truck traffic. In the case of importing goods, for example, from storage, import, or manufacturing areas, there needs to be a good access to a highway, and this kind of follows to railroad and access to and from site as well as distance. So they need to see how accessible things are, but also if it's accessible, how far it is. Even if this highway can be far, and they need to do all this kind of calculation before making decisions.
So I think next time we all start with the presentations. See if you can go up to see Jones Lang LaSalle, Cushman Wakefield, Marcus Nell. We'll check to print off some marketing research reports. We're going to write out some memo. Do a market research memo. Okay. Anybody want the last cookie?